zumindest.
Yep. Okay, let's start, so we will not be late for lunch. So this is about using OpenStack's third-party CI system, not for a company to copy CI to a company, but to another open source community. And I'm Uli Kleber from Huawei.
We have Fatih Dirmanji from Ericsson.
I'm Yolanda Raula from Red Hat.
And we will present this together. So I will firstly explain a little bit the relationship between OpenStack and OPNFV. And then I go about what we did already with the third-party CI in OpenStack, in OPNFV. Fatih will explain the details about the setup. And then we do some experience sharing from Yolanda, and I will summarize in the end. So OPNFV is a midstream project, and we use code from several open source upstream projects. Like you see in the middle bubble, there's OpenStack as the biggest one, but there are also other ones. We use that, and we put on specific telco requirements and use cases to that, so we do changes and we do additions to that. And this means we need also to create our own CI part that to produce our software. So we have dependencies between all those. How do we do that? We have requirement projects that work on certain topics in OPNFV, and a big part of these requirement projects are focusing on OpenStack. I marked that here in the lower left part with the red borderlines of the requirements projects on the left side. As you know, in the ETSI reference architecture, OpenStack provides this lower part of the mono column. And so there's more around that. This is what the other projects are about, but we start here from the OpenStack side. What is OPNFV doing with OpenStack in that connection? Our requirement projects typically have a certain workflow where we identify gaps or possible improvements for NFV usage to an upstream project, in our case OpenStack. Then we document these requirements first for ourselves and then also with the upstream project we are working with. So in OpenStack case, this means creating user stories or blueprints and discuss that then with the community. Most important step is number 6, implement those patches. What we do today is we have to test that these patches just in the upstream environment with other OpenStack components. And when the version is stable, we downstream that to OPNFV, and only then we can test these patches in the OPNFV environment before they are released in OPNFV. This leads to very long feedback cycles because we have to wait between the implementation of the patches before we can use them in OPNFV environment. We have to downstream a stable version of OpenStack. That takes too much time, so we need some improvement here. I've put this workflow also in a diagram. I will not go through it to save some time, so we have some more details of of our third-party CI setup. But you see how this feedback loop is just much too late in the development cycle. That means we only get feedback after sometimes 5 months. And this is obviously too long. So what to do about it? Fatih can solve that.
Oh, it's her solving that. So it's basically, as Uli mentioned, the feedback time is too long. Like basically a developer contributes something to OpenStack and when we get it to OPNFV, the developer forgets about the code he contributed or she contributed. So we want to make sure that we enable the fast feedback cycles between different open source communities, and OpenStack is obviously the biggest community we are working with, and we decided to start with them. And also, they also have this third-party CI mechanism that allows other communities or companies to hook into their streams and get the patches. And in order to do that, we obviously need to have some infrastructure in OPNFV side. And this was the question we have been asked a couple of times by OpenStack infra people. What are you using for CI? What your environment looks like, And these tools are the basic tools we are using in OpenStack. And the only thing I want to highlight here is that we don't use Zool. Because when you talk to OpenStack infra people, they assume you are using Zool, but we don't have Zool, and that is a kind of different than OpenStack infra tool chain. So it's basically, we have Gitgerit like OpenStack, and we have Jenkins. We don't have Zool, and we use some OpenStack utilities like Jenkins Job Builder to control and modify, configure our jobs. And we have our artifact repository. We have our Docker images stored in Docker Hub, and we have bug tracking and documentation type of stuff. And we also collect our test results in different databases and show some statistics, visualization of those things. Basically, our infrastructure utilizes all these tools to provide CI/CD support to community. And the second and perhaps more important part of OPNFV infrastructure is the hardware infrastructure. In this case, it is Pharos Labs. We have Pharos project in OPNFV, which deals with federated lab infrastructure of OPNFV. And as you can see on the map, this is a bit outdated map, which shows like 8 countries on the map, which means 8 different labs all around the world. And all those labs are connected to Jenkins, and we are able to run CI/CD in different labs in different parts of the world. And on top of the resources we are using for CI/CD, we also have additional resources for development purposes, so developers can code their features or write their test cases and so on. But the important thing here is like our hardware infrastructure is pretty good. We generally don't have issues with lack of hardware at the moment, which will help us to get this third-party CI up and running. And then using these tools and the hardware, we then set up our third-party CI. And when we say third-party CI for OpenStack in OPNFV context is that the first part, the project patch focus, this maybe you might call it like traditional third-party CI, because when you look at the other third-party CI system set up against OpenStack, they are generally interested in certain projects like Neutron. Okay, I am interested in Neutron. When a patch comes there, I run something in my company laboratory and give feedback to Neutron or NOAA. And we will do the same thing. We will hook into different Gerrit projects in OpenStack, and we will run patch set verification or post-merge type of stuff and give feedback to developers when the things happen, not like months later. But this part will have limited testing because this is not the most important thing in our third-party CI setup. The important thing in our third-party CI setup is this end-to-end platform-focused CI, and which is exactly what is our problem. Now, as Uli mentioned, we have many different upstream projects, OpenStack, OpenDaylight, KVM, and so on. And in OpenStack case, it takes months to bring OpenStack into OPNFV environment, and we generally work with stable versions, which means like months. And what we want to do is that we want to build this platform in OPNFV on a daily basis. Whenever something happens upstream or on a timer periodically, we want to install OpenStack from master in virtual environments or on bare metal and get it up and running, and then put our OPNFV specific components or other upstream components like SDN controllers, OpenV switch, or other features. And as I mentioned, we want to deploy from master. We want to cut the feedback time short, and we want to do more extensive testing using our functional testing framework or platform benchmarking frameworks and give feedback from kind of production environment to both OPNFV developers and OpenStack developers. And this is basic project patch focused third-party CI. As a developer, I contribute something to OpenStack repo, and that contribution triggers something in OPNFV CI, in this case, OPNFV Jenkins, and we build something, if something needs to be built. We do a virtual deployment, and we run smoke testing, for example, and then we give feedback to that specific project, so a developer can see, oh, I broke something in OPNFV. I should fix this, and a new patch comes, and then developer guesses, yeah, this is good, it can go ahead. On top of regular OpenStack feedback cycle, we give similar feedback from OPNFV side. And the extra thing we will do in this project patch focused CI, third-party CI, is that we also want to build things from OpenStack and store them on our artifact repo and consume them in our projects internally in OPNFV. What this means is that whenever something gets submitted into projects we are looking after, we will start running build jobs, virtual deployment, test jobs, and so on to see if that thing is good enough to pull into OPNFV. And if it is good enough, we'll promote that to our artifact repository, a tarball, a Debian package, an RPM, and we will store it on our artifact repository. And the rest of OPNFV CI, if we have some other projects are interested in those artifacts, we'll pull them down from OPNFV artifact repository and do bare metal deployment and testing this time. So essentially, we will cut more time here as well. An example to this could be fuel plugins. Again, fuel plugins, it takes a couple of months to get them into new OPNFV release. With this, we want to do that in a day. Whenever someone sends a new change to fuel plugins, one of them, we will be able to pull them back down to OPNFV fuel. And this part is basically the end-to-end platform-focused CI, and this is where things are a bit tricky. And here, in this case, we basically want all these OPNFV or OpenStack developers to continue their day-to-day work as it is now, but we want to do things in OPNFV environment and give feedback to them. And it's basically provisions, some bare metal resources, and install OpenStack on them with the latest contributions that happened during yesterday, for example, and tell the people what happened. And we decided to do things in same as OpenStack infra. In this case, it is Bifrost and Puppet Infra Cloud. So if a certain if OpenStack developers want to contribute in OPNFV and vice versa, they shouldn't see any difference between this type of stuff when they move between different communities. So this will make it easier for developers to contribute to both communities as well. And this is where Yolanda will explain us, tell us what she has been doing last 2-3 months. Yeah. She put lots of efforts and she made things happen.
So. Okay, so I'm going to talk a bit about the Puppet Infra Cloud project. Puppet Infra Cloud is just an OpenStack lightweight installer that is based on Puppet modules, and the main intention is to deploy just an OpenStack with a testing purposes. It doesn't mean to go on production. So it's composed of several projects. We are using Bifrost. That's for orchestrating all the bare metal servers. We use all the Puppet modules. Puppet Infra Cloud, it is the proper installer that we use on OpenStack Infra, and we are reusing now on OPNFV. We use the Schemage Builder as well to build all the deployment images, and we also rely on Glean, that is just like a replacement for Cloud Init, to install all the settings on the server. So the basic requirements to deploy an Infra Cloud, we just need a VM to put all the Bifrost controller here, and then we will need just 2 bare metal servers at the moment, just one for the controller and one for the compute. In terms of requirements, the VM needs to have access to the IPMI network to take control of power control of the servers, and then we need to have access as well to the Pixieboot network to be able to manage it. And we need just like 8 GB of VM, so it's not much requirement. And how does it work? I mean, the first step, we need to just deploy the Bifrost controller. That Bifrost is just a set of playbooks that deploy an Ironic server, a standalone Ironic. Then so we can take care and manage all the bare metal servers. So we start with this VM, install Bifrost there. We need to configure all the settings for Bifrost because everything is different depending on your lab. So you need to configure the network settings, VLANs, IP ranges. You also have the freedom to choose if you want to deploy Ubuntu, CentOS, depending on your needs as well. So you configure all these settings before applying the Puppet manifest for Bifrost. And you also need to define the inventory of your server. So you have different environmental servers, so you typically define the IPMI IP for the server, the user and the password, the MAC address that you are going to be using for Pixieboot. And with that, you have a Bifrost, an Ironic controller just ready. After that, you need to do like 2 steps. First, you need what we call enroll. What the enroll process is that it takes all the data from the inventory, you pass it to Bifrost, and it just adds all the nodes into the database to be able to manage it. And then you have the deploy process that is properly doing the setup of the servers. So what this deploy process does basically is that it just takes control of the power of the servers using IPMI. It restarts the servers, and then it starts with the pixieboot process. In the pixieboot process, it typically just copies the deployment image that you want to install on the servers, and you copy a config drive as well with all the network that you need, hostname, SSH keys. So that's copied onto to the servers. When it is done, it is rebooted again, and next time, the servers are just booting from hard drive, and you have it totally deployed. What it means to have the server totally ready, I mean, we have the operating system that we want with the configuration we want. All the network is totally configured with your settings. SSH keys are ready, so you can connect to the servers. And, well, you have the hostname set as well, so you don't have to configure anything manually. It is ready just to apply all the manifests. So when the deploy process is just finished, you can SSH to the controller and to the compute, and then apply Puppet manifest again to just run the components you need there, and you totally have like a cloud working at this moment. It is just thought for functional testing, so the main advantages of this, it is quite fast. I mean, you can have it ready in 20 minutes, or pretty good compared to other installers that are just focused on production. So that's more or less what we are achieving. So we want to just have this ready for functional testing and to be repeating again and again. I mean, pulling from master periodically and do this functional testing all the time to be sure that everything is working on our environment and it's ready to be consuming for the developers. So at the moment, we are at these steps that we have this functional testing up and running. We are adding third-party CI to several projects. For example, this is done with Bifrost. We want to do it with Puppet InfraCloud as well. And this is this functional testing is also available on OpenStack Jenkins right now. The challenges, the main challenges that I found when trying to reuse this Puppet Infra Cloud, it was totally focused for infra, and we are trying to use it on OpenFV now. So that was the main pain. And everything was top for infra, so it was only available for Ubuntu. The manifest didn't even run on CentOS or SUSE, so we had to modify it, make some patches to make it work. Now there is proper support on these three platforms. Also, all the network settings were totally hard-coded on the manifest. I mean, if you move this to another lab, this wouldn't work. So what we made is to make it configurable. Everything relies on Puppet Hydra now, so when you want to deploy on another environment, you just change the Hydra settings, you apply again, and everything works again. Also, I found several races, and it's typical from Puppet that you hit races. When you apply Puppet the first time, it works. It doesn't work the second time, the first time, until it works. So it's just a blocker for an automated test. So I had to correct several bugs of this type to make it work once. And also we needed another features, because we moved to another lab. Our lab settings were very different in terms of NICs, VLANs, and there were features not present really on the Glean, for example, that is the Cloud Init replacement over Bifrost. So we implemented that. We contributed to these projects to make it better and to be able to reuse in another platform, so that's quite good. And also then another difficulty that we are having is that not much people or not much projects in OpenStack are aware on how can they do third-party CI on their projects. It is not really well documented. It was really hard to know how to set up it and how to make it look properly. This is something that needs to be improved and more documented, we think. Okay, so about the next step, as I was talking, this was totally focused on Ubuntu. We need to finish the support for CentOS and SUSE. That is nearly done. Currently, we are using a stable Mitaka because it's what Puppet Infra Cloud Infra is using, but our intention is to move to master. It shouldn't be really difficult, but I think we may hit some problems with the Puppet manifest if some config has changed or a new format, data format comes. We need to test it as well. We need to introduce HA because, I mean, we are just running with a compute and a controller. Our idea is to just provide HA so we can run with three controllers and two computes. So that's a job that needs to be done as well. In terms of networking, the Puppet Infra Cloud was very simple. It was using just Linux Bridge and provided networks for to be able to use with OpenFV. We need to add OpenV Switch support as well. And also we need to introduce gradually some other improvements for OpenFV. So there is job that needs to be done here. So if anyone is interested in contributing, it will be very helpful for us. And yes, as well, we would need to enable third-party CI for more projects. I mean, every project that is really involved with this effort should have the third-party CI to be sure that it's working for us and it's not breaking on production. So that's more or less my experience I wanted to share. And I will pass now to Ali.
Thanks, Yolanda. Now, this last bullet, I want to give some more words about it. Like, when we say about third-party CI for more projects, we are talking in OpenStack context here, enable third-party CI for other plugins and so on. But if we look at OPNFV again, we have lots of different upstream communities, OpenStack, Open Daylight, ONOS, KVM, OVS, and so on. And this actually says that we will enable third-party CI for other communities as well. And we already started talking with Open Daylight people to see how we can bring Open Daylight into OPNFV faster as well. So because, again, with Open Daylight, we have some slowness when it comes to feedback and some manual steps are involved there. And they have great ideas, and we want to make this happen for Open Daylight. So when we get OpenStack, we can put latest Open Daylight on top of it and give even more proper and faster feedback. So we will continue working with other communities to enable third-party CI with them as well. And with this third-party CI setup, the development workflow changes drastically. And as it says there, the feedback time can go down to 1 day, essentially. And the difference between this diagram and the previous diagram is that green fast feedback line. So basically, when OpenStack gets any patch set or master moves on OpenStack Garrett, we can directly pull that down into OPNFV CI, and we can test it properly and give feedback to developers who contribute to those patches to OpenStack. And this can go on and on and on, and the fixes can be provided faster, the issues can be detected faster, and then we can essentially put this platform together, latest version and working version of the platform together on a daily basis. And then this will help us too much to move things both in OPNFV and other communities, and in this case, it's OpenStack. And additional benefits of this is basically, again, patches by OpenStack developers can be tested early in OPNFV environment. As I mentioned, like, our hardware infrastructure is pretty good, and we are kind of donating test environment to OpenStack. If you look at from OpenStack perspective, we are not using their resources. We are not asking them to give us any resources, but we are saying, okay, we will run testing of OpenStack in our environment, and this will give feedback to OpenStack developers as well, because we will not filter the changes between OPNFV and OpenStack when we deploy from master. Master will come, and whoever contributes to that master will their stuff tested in OPNFV environment, and this will help OpenStack to improve the quality as well. And the features of OpenStack can be tested and the usability of them improved in NFV deployments. Since if you check the sessions of this summit, there are lots of NFV related talks, and this will benefit to NFV related work in OpenStack. And again, the OpenStack and OPNFV, the patches coming to OpenStack and impacts or dependencies to OPNFV can be tested early and can be found early and corrected, fixed early. And the other thing, like when OPNFV developers come up with a new feature, they go to OpenStack, create a blueprint, and once the blueprint is approved, they go and code it there. But it might take time for OpenStack community to take and accept this change because they might not have enough data to approve that change. With this third-party CI, we are hoping that we will give this type of feedback from real bare metal environment and then help reviewers in OpenStack community to hopefully approve this type of changes faster, because then they can check the OPNFV CI and see, oh, this worked there, then we should approve this. and the backward compatibility is the other thing. And as I mentioned in previous slide, the third-party CI principle can be applied and will be applied to different communities. We are starting with OpenStack now. We will start with Open Daylight, and we hopefully will start other open source communities if they are willing to contribute to this work by their ideas. We don't ask them to come and fix our problems for us. We want them to tell us if we are doing things in right way, in proper way, and adding value, not the hassle.
Yes, to summarize what that means. So OpenStack third-party CI is a good means for us to help us to solve these issues. So OpenStack third-party CI is a tool which is well suited for this synchronization between two open source projects, not only for the synchronization between companies. What is it meant for from OpenStack side on the first side? This concept using in the open source communities, it's not only a benefit for OPNFV. We see a big benefit for OpenStack as well. So it's a win-win situation between both communities. And we also saw in the experience sharing that third-party CI is easy to establish in such an environment, and it will take immediate effect. We were very fast in seeing this benefit in this setup. And there, as an outlook in the future, to transfer that to not only OpenStack, but all these other open source communities, we see there much more benefit for both OPNFV and all the other open source communities where we can establish these methods for. So this is a summary there. Do you have questions? We are a little bit early, so we have time enough.
We have 5-6 minutes for questions, I think. Do you like this? as developers, I suppose you are doing stuff in OPNFV or OpenStack, and this will hopefully relieve some problems by running things in this type of bare metal environment and giving you faster feedback, so you don't have to remember what you coded months ago or chase other people to look at your code you contributed months ago. Yeah. And obviously, we are doing this for both communities, and it is not limited to OPNFV developers. OpenStack developers can come and ask for stuff if they think we can do this in a better way. We are open to all the ideas and do things in a better way.
Yeah.
How are you going to integrate the SDN controllers and stuff into OpenStack, basically the manifest that deploy the machine? Is it like an extra plugin or something, or are you just like once it's like the third parties deployed, and then you want to pass that one system?
Yeah, so this is something that it needs to be done. The first step is to add the OpenV switch and the proper network support in the Puppet Infra Cloud. And normally, all these projects have Puppet modules already there because they are used for another installer. So I think the idea that can be modular. I mean, we just go with the basic cloud deployment, and then we could just consume these modules depending on the needs to add proper networking as well. Not directly them, they want just a basic cloud installation, but the feedback that I have from them is that as long as we make it modular, so maybe from our side, the Puppet modules are there because they're every time that a new feature comes in OpenStack, there is a Puppet module, because for example, OOO is using that. But the problem with OOO is that it's very heavy, it's not ideal for testing, but we can consume the same things as well. It's a term of figuring how to do it in a modular way without affecting the other projects using it.
Yeah, the other thing is we are working directly upstream for Bifrost and Puppet Infra Cloud, and we try to push as much as possible to upstream if they are not complicating stuff for OpenStack Infra. And if they see, okay, this is really not something we should have in OpenStack infra, we might keep them local to OPNFV until they see the need, and then we can put them back to OpenStack infra. Mm-hmm. I will basically consume this type of Puppet manifest. Like, we have those manifests for different OPNFV projects or plugins as well. So we can reuse all those things from either OpenStack or different install projects we have. And really, we shouldn't reinvent the stuff. We should reuse as much as possible and contribute to existing stuff rather than coming up with something from scratch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that how it works is that we have the Relang project. That is where we have all the manifests really there on the for our installation. And then we are consuming the Puppet Infra Cloud models. It doesn't mean that we can just need to consume this. We can consume Puppet Infra Cloud, and we also can consume our models if we need, as long as we can glue together in a clear way.
Yeah, it's, in Relang, we have really, really OpenNFV specific stuff. It's like hardware specific stuff and the deployment type of stuff. So it is, most everything is upstream. And as Yolanda mentioned while she is talking, it's basically we hopefully enable more communities or companies to reuse OpenStack infra tools internally, because we are trying to make those utilities consumable by anyone running in any lab, not just OpenStack infra.
I think with Triple O, it provides all these features, but it's very heavy, and I mean, they do.
Maybe they are doing, but they are. When it comes to different installers, the priorities are different. Like for this work, we provide this as a service, and our only priority is developers' benefit. If they need this thing faster, we help them to get faster. But when you look at the other installers, they might have extra features on top of OpenStack, and those features might take priority from pulling down master and installing from master. Maybe that's why they are chasing stable versions.
Yeah. I mean, Triple O in upstream, in infra, they are just doing from master. The problem is that the installers that go on top of it, open daylight, the Apex. Or
it's basically pushing fuel upstream, not OpenStack upstream. Apex is pushing Triple O upstream, not the OpenStack upstream, and so on. We are directly pushing OpenStack.
Would it make so much sense for fuel at OpenStack to push
OpenStack? Do you have any other question, Eric? Sorry. Any questions more?
Okay, then thank you for coming and enjoy your lunch.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.